Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
Welcome back to our Bread for the Journey series. As we continue now in our Epiphany term, is focusing on theology. And this year, we're focusing on some of the I believe statements from our creed. This week, we are going to be talking about I believe in God the Father. Next week, we'll be talking about I believe in God the Son. Then we'll have Dr. Dominic Serra from Catholic University come and talk about I believe in God the Holy Spirit. And then we will wrap up with Father Richard talking about I believe in the Church. But this evening, it's my wonderful privilege to introduce to you one of my systematic theology professors from seminary, Dr. Catherine Sonderegger. She's the William Meade Professor of Systematic Theology at Virginia Theological Seminary. And if you have not ever heard her speak before, you will fall in love with her as all of her students do. So thank you very much for being with us.
Thank you very much, Sean. You can imagine all faculty fell in love with Sean. It was just to have Sean as a student, as a leader, a priest eventually in our midst, was a great gift of Almighty God to us. I wanted to reflect with you for a brief period of time about the creedal statement, belief in God the Father, do it in three large parts, but my plan is to give you some time to respond and to raise questions, to head in different directions than I have enunciated with you. So I think we're going until 8 or 8:30, is that right?
8 o'clock.
So I will try to hold my horses in check and not go the entire hour. Three large groupings on the belief in God as Father. I want to look first at the way in which the fatherhood of God has served as a kind of unifying, ecumenical, but in some periods of our history, an interfaith affirmation. And I want to associate this with a politician from my youth that some of you may remember, and certainly others will remember historically, Hubert Humphrey. Then I want to take a look at the significance of the fatherhood of God as a definition of the Christian life. The belief or affirmation or trust in the paternity, the paternal goodwill of God, being an account, a shorthand account of what it means to be Christian, to be a disciple. And that I am going to associate with the great name of John Calvin. And then finally, I want to look at God as Father in a creedal or Trinitarian liturgical sense. And there I want to rely on one of the great doctors of the Church coming out of our Eastern tradition, Gregory of Nyssa. So first, thinking about the fatherhood of God as a ecumenical and interfaith statement of unity with the happy warrior Hubert Humphrey as our representative. Now you may remember when Hubert Humphrey began campaigning for the presidency, he started using a phrase. Now let's say a little bit more about this phrase. But a phrase that became very well known in American politics that went like this. We believe in the brotherhood of man under the fatherhood of God. Now this phrase that joins brotherhood of the human race, of mankind, with the fatherhood of God, has its anchor in the post-war world of the United States. I think probably it has some deep European ties as well. The conviction here was that there was something in the United States, in our democratic society, in the post-war world, that was going to acknowledge a certain religious breadth in the American people. It's a very important book written in this post-war period entitled A Catholic Protestant Jew. And this was a book that was going to give voice to a certain form of expanded definition about what the religious life of the American people is like. And one of the ways in which this expanded view was going to be expressed was by joining together a human fellowship and unity under an overarching account of God as Father. So Humphrey took up this phrase, the brotherhood of man and the under the fatherhood of God, and he used it to express the conviction that when people recognize something like a divine being or life that is in some way not only ruler but parent, a governor who was also kin, that the effect of this on those who acknowledge God as Father would be to see each other as members of a large family, the brotherhood of man. Now, notice here we get a conviction that religious life is fundamentally ethical in character. I think this was a very important part of this movement in American religious life. Being religious, recognizing the paternal graciousness and protection of God, was not simply a bare belief. It wasn't simply an acknowledgement about a particular property or character of deity. It was also a way of life that unified a diverse people, a war-weary people beginning to recover and rebuild an American democratic society. Now you'll notice that that is a deeply gendered phrase. This is a second way we might reflect on the fatherhood of God, the brotherhood of man. Janet Soskus, who is a systematic theologian who teaches at the University of Cambridge, has written a book of reflections on the gendered nature of language for God. And she advocates, as many feminist systematicians do, an expansion of language for God and a notice of the rich variety of images and family language that is available in Holy Scripture to speak of Almighty God. But that's not the only thing she says. She's also interested in the way this language of brotherhood and of fatherhood is deeply familial in character. It signals a kinship belonging to a single family that she thinks is central to the Christian life. She picks up on the way in which the Apostle Paul speaks about the early Christians as members of a single family, brothers and sisters to one another. And all of this related to God, who is in some way like the head of a large family. Now, notice if you think along these lines, and Suskus has some lovely reflections along these lines, if you think in this way, you're inclined to say that the relation between human beings and God is not one of complete otherness. It's not the case that human creatures or creatures in general are utterly other and altogether different from Almighty God. But in fact, there is some kind of family likeness. There's distinct difference. There's transcendence and immanence, infinite and finite, the holiness and purity of God, and the frail and broken quality of human beings. But we are in some kind of larger structure that Suskus refers to as kinship. So all of these aspects, the ethical quality, the political dimension, and the family relation, I think, are bound up in this broad interfaith and ecumenical notion of the fatherhood of God. Part one. Questions about that? Do you want to stop and just throw out a question or comment, and then I'll go to part two, or do you want me to forge ahead? Sean, fire away.
So, would you, I think I know the answer just from having read an article that you've written on this topic, but the idea that the term father is culturally bound is you know, based on the fact that in the ancient world, it was mostly patrilinear type of family situation, so the father was considered to be the head of the family. I hear you suggesting that there's more to it than that, that there's something about that word that is deeper, perhaps, or more longer lasting than just a culturally bound understanding.
Yeah, Sean knows that my own conviction is that this language of fatherhood is important to us Christians in a very concrete and distinctive way, because it is the language that our Lord used. And the prayer that is the one dearest to us and taught from our mother and father's knee, the Lord's Prayer, is an address to God not only as the Father of Jesus Christ, but our Father. So I think there's something enduring and irreducible about this language. Now, Janet Suskus has a slightly different view about this. I think she is less impressed by this biblical anchoring that is important to me. But she says that one of the important aspects of paternity in thinking about God is not only this kinship that I was mentioning before, but also the relation between fathers and children is different than that between mothers and children in a biological way. The way in which all of us are our mother's kin, is that we were once part of her life. We lived inside her and were not able to survive without her. There's an internal intimacy between children and their mothers that is not true of fathers. However intimate we are with our father, we don't begin our life inside him. And we don't have a period of our existence when we are actually part of his organism, his body. So Janet and some other feminist theologians think that fatherhood is significant as a marker of the distinctiveness of God from creatures. That we are under his guidance and protection, his love and his rule, but we are not part of him. We are not inside him in the way that children are inside their mothers. So this would be a second way to think about fatherhood as a broad cultural, but also physical, embodied, biological term that is in some way, and we can talk about the different ways, but in some way applied to Almighty God. Yeah, great. Other comments or questions, please.
This is a concept that father-father is a concept that I'm very comfortable with and always have been. And I, at some point, recognize that how grateful I was that I had such a loving and wonderful earthly father that set me up to extend, yeah. You know. And, but I wonder, therefore, how people who don't have a positive view of father deal with God the Father.
That's a wonderful question, and I think that too is a central aspect of this broad discussion about using family names for God. Now there are some people for whom their relation to their earthly father was one of fear, one of abuse, one of abandonment, for whom that term, fatherhood, is something too painful or infuriating or terrifying to apply to God and becomes a source of alienation. And especially if their father had been demeaning to them as children, perhaps particularly as girls. I think there are a number of people of different religious persuasions, different religious traditions, for whom the language of fatherhood has become dead, or perhaps worse, threatening and alien. There are other people for whom the lack of a father, or the lack of a loving father, has made the fatherhood language even more valuable to them. And this is, Carolyn Bynum has a very interesting article in which she argues that religious language is always multivalent. It just always has this richness that surprises us. And I think this is one example of that there are times where someone who has experienced only emptiness or hostility or fear, contempt from an earthly father, longs to know a true father, a father who actually loves and sustains and guides. And so for some people, the abuse of an earthly father demands a heavenly father who is a glorious and good Father. All of these things, I think when we think about language for God, enter in. It's true in a broad political sense. It's true in a kind of family sense. It's true in a psychotherapeutic sense. And it's true liturgically. Right? Yeah, excellent question.
You know,
all right,
so
go
many,
ahead.
We're living in a society, as you well know, in which an increasing number of people don't know their Father.
Mm-hmm.
They've never had the experience at all of it.
That's right.
So the imagery of it must be a bit mystifying to them.
Right.
Because they've just never, I'm like Edie, mm-hmm. I had a loving father and loving grandfather. Mm-hmm. And so I get the ideal, but I can imagine people who don't know their Father and who perhaps never knew a grandfather because they're like the second generation to be raised by a single mother. This imagery must be a bit difficult to come to understanding.
Yeah, and there's some biblical warrant for reflecting on the difficulty here, because you remember that our Lord says, call no man father on earth, because you all have one Father, the Father in heaven. Now, it could be that what that verse is, at least in part, aimed to teach us, is that we actually learn what fatherhood is not by our earthly fathers, if we happen to have them, but by God. So, it's actually by standing before God, being in His presence, receiving from His hand, that we understand what being a father is, and in that way could actually recognize not only our own parent perhaps being a father, but other people being fathers to us, teachers and friends. I think there are plenty of women who can be father in just that way. And in fact, this is just a little parenthesis, but in my own thinking about clerical titles, I had thought at one time that it might be a very good thing if women priests were also called father, to indicate just this richness of the term and the way in which it is not entirely anchored in a physical or biological pattern. If you did not know earthly fatherhood, perhaps you would be better instructed, because God Himself would teach you what fatherhood is. Oh, please.
I don't know enough about psychology and the human nature, but it seems as if there may be a longing for parental. I once saw this movie, Slumdog Millionaire, you know, all these little orphans that, and the whole message was love, this longing for love.
Mm-hmm. Yes, and it may be, this is part of what Janet Suskus
yes.
thinks, that we long for love, for purpose, for shelter, but we long for it in a particular way, to be part of a large kinship, part of a large family, so that love is not simply an abstraction, but carries that sense of being connected that gives us a relationship to God as Father, but also gives us this sense of being knit up with one another, so that all of you become my kin in a deep way. It's not only that we're part of a church, that we share religious convictions, that we long to be disciples of Christ, but we also are these adopted heirs. We're also sons and daughters of the living God, of the one Father. So this, I think it's this impulse, this longing to be of the same family with you that Humphrey picked up on when he used that phrase to indicate that humanity is a family, and it's a family in virtue of the fact that God is a father. All right, second large category. We're making progress. See, it's 7:30 and I'm already in the point two. This is so good. Okay. Now this is a way of thinking about the fatherhood of God that has to do with the Christian life. Not so much now about how it is we are to understand the human creature in light of the paternal grace and protection of God, but to think now about what it would mean as believers, as human beings, to consider ourselves under the benevolent protection and chastening of God the Father. This idea, this turning toward the paternal guidance of God preoccupied Calvin in the third book of the Institutes. Calvin was himself deeply committed to Luther's idea that faith is fundamentally a kind of trust, that the beating heart of the Christian life is not so much particular beliefs as it is a way of life and a life of confident trust. And Calvin devotes a whole long section of his lifetime work, The Institutes of the Christian Religion, a whole long book to the doctrine of faith. And in this book, Calvin, who is himself an exile from France, he's in constant conflict with the leaders of this city that he is reforming, Geneva, and his health is always precarious. In the midst of this, Calvin lays out in some gloriously vivid language the way in which we are to receive all things from God as from a fatherly hand. Now, interestingly, this for Calvin is consistent with, I think probably especially designed to meet two things that are of particular concern to us as present-day Christians. The experience of doubt, of uncertainty, of wavering conviction, and of suffering. Calvin did not think, that is, that if we acknowledge God as Father and we put our trust in Him, he didn't think that meant you never doubted and you never suffered. He thought, in fact, a sign of this kind of faithful trust was that in the midst of your great struggles with the faith, with the uncertainties, but also this wrestling, the dark night of the soul, the wrestling of Jacob at the Jabbok, the limping that is part of the Christian life, Calvin thought in the midst of this, we, in our trust in God as Father, we call out to Him. It's a very moving section of this book where Kelvin imagines that it's something like being in a prison cell, this time of struggle and doubt. But at the top of the cell is a small window that's been cut into the wall. And though we are in prison, and though it is a time of great conflict, of anguish, we raise our head up and our eyes look toward the light. This, Kelvin says, is really what faith is like. This is what it is to trust in God's paternal benevolence. It's not to be constantly confident. It's not to be constantly joyful, though these are great gifts if you have them. But it's that in the midst of doubt, we call upon God. We raise our voice. We turn toward Him. We raise our head to the light. Kelvin also thought that in the midst of suffering, we may very well lament and protest. He didn't think this was ruled out of the life of faith. He thought we may very well read the Psalms, the imprecatory Psalms, where anger as well as lament is given voice to. We may well rail against injustice. We might be overcome by the sense that the world is an alien and terrifying place. We might call upon Psalm 88 or upon the book of Job. Kelvin thought this was consistent with belief in God as Father. Because what we're asked to do in faith, he says, is not deny suffering, not deny its cost. We are not to ignore the hard truths of the world. But instead, in the midst of this, we rely upon God. We turn toward Him. We say, even this I receive from God's paternal hand. This, he thought, was a pattern of faithful trust that is what we long to live out in the Christian life. Now, this, I think, is a very rich and sometimes poignant account of what it means to confess that God is Father, and treats this matter of theodicy, the problem of suffering, and the problem of doubt. Questions or comments about this point? Please. No, this is so good.
How does that square with God the Father's nature as omnipotent?
Yeah, good. Right. Notice that if someone like Kelvin, who is deeply committed to divine omnipotence and to a very full-throated account of election and predestination, Kelvin is not going to back down one moment from either of these claims. He thinks that what we do when we call out to God the Father is that we see that there is in the divine will, in the fatherly will, a kind of depth, what he sometimes calls the hidden will or the abyss of God, that is beyond our knowing. He thinks that it's possible that the kind of suffering that is part of the world and part of our life may be in some way contrary to God's will, but also at the same time consonant with some deep reserve in the majestic fatherly will of God. And the trial for a Christian, he thinks, is to see those events not as punishment, not as an inexorable fate, not as just a cold necessity, but instead to trust that there is some consolation, some chastening, some lesson, some purpose that God has in the midst of what may be a great rebellion against God's own rule, and that God in his omnipotence is bringing this to flower. Now this is of course going to be very difficult to balance. On one hand, the strong affirmation of the darkness of the path for us and the reality of a suffering world, and a clear conviction that in this, not above it or behind it, but in it, God is Father, and we trust that. There's a very moving section of Dietrich Bonhoeffer's Poetry and Letters from Prison, where he says that as he faces death, his imminent execution, he knows the fear of death, and he knows the terror that he may be faithless in the middle of it, and he knows the injustice, and he knows the loss to his family and friends. And even this he takes as from God's fatherly hand. But now, this is the language of a faithful martyr, and that's not language that all of us can or should use, but it is Calvin's instinct about divine omnipotence and benevolence. Yeah, are there questions or any comments about the second use? Please, Sean.
I just wanted to share a comment related, I think, to what Edie was talking about, regarding God's omnipotence in this whole sense of suffering in the world, which is something that plagues all Christian thinkers, how to explain it. And I think I take this from my own personal life, suffering, I see suffering as a pedagogy in love.
Mm-hmm. You are a patristic thinker, so that's lovely. Yeah.
That this is how mm-hmm. we learn to love, mm-hmm. is through suffering. And I mean, wouldn't it be wonderful if we could learn to love without it? But that just doesn't seem to be our nature as human beings. And that we, and I can think of this in my own life, I don't have to go into grand examples. You know, I have been most loving in my life when I have been able to have compassion, suffer with another
mm-hmm.
person, to be able to understand the suffering they're going through, because in some way I went through something similar myself. And had I not, I don't think I would be able to open my heart to that person in the same way. And that's helped me with pastorally in dealing with just horrible things that happen in people's lives, unexpected tragedies that happen. And I see, and it doesn't always lead to love. Sometimes it leads to resentment,
that's right,
hatred, and all kinds of other things. But I think that that's a large part of what suffering is to teach us to love one another.
There's a wonderful section in Basil the Great's reflections on the problem of evil, where he makes a very strong argument for this divine pedagogy, and that we are broken by suffering, but broken open too, so that we feel this kinship relation. And what is always difficult is to know in the divine pedagogy how to recognize that some suffering is wrong, how to preserve the wrongness of suffering, the kind of abuse that some of you raised, thinking about paternal imagery for God. How to acknowledge that some of this is not in itself good, even if we learn from it. Not to make evil our good in some way. And yet, at the same time, to live with that in trust that something good is being done in it and through it, which is part of this deep spiritual notion of paternal pedagogy. Yeah. And of course, it's going to be always delicate. This is not a Euclidean geometric proposal that we're going to lay out and define our terms and come to a proof in the end. There's going to be some kind of mystery at the heart of suffering that we will never master and penetrate. And this is part of what Calvin means about trust. Part of this sense of trusting another person is that in the things that they do we don't understand, we say that I don't really see why they're doing this, but I know that they have my own good in mind. I know that this is a trustworthy person. And in time I will see, in time I will understand. But this is, by some distant analogy, Calvin thinks applied to the paternal majesty of God. Good, yes, please.
This is just a little more on the same thing, but I think Father Sean and I were having a mind meld. Because before you spoke, I was sitting here reflecting on the fact that one of the things I've learned to do over the years, when there's a bad time, a suffering time, a difficult time, a failure, or whatever, I've learned to immediately go to what am I to learn from this. And often it's about love, and often it's just about this didn't work out, but, you know, door closes, you open a window kind of thing. Something else may be coming along that maybe even I'm better equipped for now that I've been through that.
Yes.
But somehow always there's love at the center of it.
Yes.
And I think important with all this that we do as the Orthodox say, we cling to the belief that even as I go down to the grave, I will say, oh, you're all here.
Yes, that's that counterstroke, that nevertheless, is another way that we can think about Calvin's ideas. So sometimes there is the kind of suffering in which we can say, I discern God's hand in this. This is to inculcate patience or humility or gratitude in me. And this is the kind of event that Augustine often writes about in the Confessions. But I think there are also events that seem in themselves to have no purpose, no meaning, are simply pain, are abuse, are demeaning, are hate crimes. And it is there, I think, that Calvin's instinct is to say, nevertheless, all the same, at the grave, we make our hallelujah. Now that moment where you say, this is evil, and nevertheless, I trust in God. This pattern Calvin will use frequently to say that there are things that take place in the world that God is working to good. Luther has a famous section in the Freedom of a Christian where he argues like this too, that God's omnipotence is making all things, even evil, work for good. But they remain evil rather than good. And that's this, nevertheless, the counterstroke.
Of course, you know, we have our Anglican version of that in the Holy Angels, right? Whatever you sin till life shall end be filled with grace.
Yes, yes, that is right. Lovely. Okay, part three. I at least we'll get a good start on this, and then we can see. Now, of course, God the Father is a term used in the creeds and in the doctrine of Trinity and in our liturgy. And I wanted to refer to another of the Cappadocian fathers, Gregory Nyssa, as an exemplar in this third use. Now, the Cappadocian Fathers, a group of intellectuals in the Greek-speaking world, a sister, Macrina, Gregory Basil, and then a friend, Gregory Nazianzus, they defended the doctrine of Trinity in the 4th century in what is now Asia Minor, Turkey, and carried out a series of pamphlet wars about the doctrine of Trinity. And one of these was a treatise against Eunomius, which is one of the central texts by Gregory Nyssa about the doctrine of Trinity. And in it, in part, Gregory offers to us, I think, this kind of reflection on the doctrine of God. He thinks when we use the language of Father, and of course then Son and Holy Spirit, we are affirming that within deity itself, within the reality that is God, there is both origin and generativity. Now, these are really deep and interesting things to say about God. It's easy in the ancient world, as it is in our world, to imagine that God is something like a power or an abstract notion like goodness or truth, or a reality that is simply self-same all the way through, the way an element, an earthly element, is consistently and always itself, gold, all the way through and all the way down. What Gregory says is that God is actually a reality far more mysterious than that. far more radically unique than something that is consistent in this way. There is, in fact, in deity itself, a starting point, an origin, something like a beginning or a principle. And there is a dynamism in God, a life, a generative life that is part of what we mean when we say God. Now, to bring that point closer to our topic, Gregory would say, to call God Father is to acknowledge that God is not simply a father in the way he responds to us. And the first two points I've been focusing on God's relation to creatures, the way in which we as creatures call God Father and what that means for our life. Gregory says we do that not because it's just one of the ways God interacts with us, but because in the mystery who is God, there is something like origin, absolute origin or principle, and there is something dynamic, life-giving within deity itself. If there were never a world, never a cosmos, there would still be these two, the origin and the production of life. That simply is God. So God is Father in that in some way he is the principle or origin, we might even say the starting point of deity. Something like an absolute at the very pinnacle and reality of God. And this principle, this origin of deity itself, we call Father. And this principle is not simply a starting point, like the first point in a line, but in fact, this principle generates the reality and mystery of God. And this we call the Son, which takes place in this outpouring of the Spirit. So for the Cappadocian Fathers to say God is Father is to say that within the mystery of God itself, there is this relation of origin to the word or reality that is generated, begotten, not made. And without taking too much of the thunder from Father Sean's presentation, you can see there that calling God Father is implying the reality of the mystery of the Word or the Son. There's something like a relationship between this origin and the life that is constantly pouring forth out of this source. And this is the triune life that just is God. So when we in the Eucharist offer up all our prayers to God the Father after the Sursum Corda and the Sanctus, we are there following this pattern that is God's very life. What the Greek called a taxis, an ordering, in which we begin with this source, this origin, and we rehearse that generativity. Not only that God creates the world and all that is in it, but that God is himself, the source, the origin of begetting. And that this is an eternal state in God, an eternal dynamism and fruitfulness that then is poured down into our world in the incarnation and the giving of the Spirit. And we receive that in Eucharist and raise it back up in the Spirit back to the Father. So that in the Eucharist, in our prayers, in the practice of saying the Our Father, we are joining in this great dynamism that is the eternal life of God. Well, that was kind of one big long sentence. So you may have some questions or reflections about this. This is the most technical, maybe, or abstract of the three. This is the way in which fatherhood belongs not to God, it's hard to say this, not to God exhaustively, but to God as a person of the Trinity.
Then
please.
Something we said right at the end made me think of that book, I think it's Alton that wrote, Participation in God.
Good.
You know, by us participating in the life of God, but also God participating, you know, that ongoing action,
yes.
God is a verb kind of idea, and then we as sons and daughters of God, part of the family are participating in God.
Yes, right. And this notion, the metaxis that is part of the heritage of Platonism in the ancient world that becomes important in the Greek fathers, this idea suggests, I think, for Christians, that God being the living God is more important, it's more central to our faith than we sometimes acknowledge. We can participate in God, we can participate the divine reality just because God is living and generative. It's this way in which God is the river of life, not inert, not simply a power or force, but this fruitfulness that then is given to us so that we can give it back. This is a kind of exchange that is true because God is not simply an idea, but a life. I know we are past 8, and I don't want to keep you at this, but we can talk about more things if you want, and we can also have Compline or final comments.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.